You're listening to audio from The Village Church, a community that's formed by the gospel and sent on God's mission, gathering weekly in the heart of downtown Hamilton, Ohio. For more information about The Village or to connect with us, you can find us online at myvillagechurch.com.
Good morning. My name is Michael. I'm one of the pastors here. Thanks so much for hanging out with us. I'm going to pray, and then we will get rolling. Father, what a gift to be gathered together as your people, with your people. What a gift to be able to sit under your word, to learn about you, to learn what it looks like to walk in your ways. And Holy Spirit, would you shine bright all the places that are exposed and that are cut open by your word in each of us. And would you just throw us to the foot of the cross where Jesus slays himself so that we might be free, that we might experience freedom, that we might be free from sin, that we might be free from death, that we might be free from hell, and that we might be free in our ability to walk with you, not just today, not just tomorrow, but forever. Would you shine bright your light so that we might know you, trust you, treasure you in the fullness of who you are in a way that maybe we never have. In Jesus' name, amen. Following Jesus faithfully is a matter of the heart. And I know just that idea, it probably hits everybody differently, and some of you are far from Jesus, and some of you have maybe never walked with Jesus, and some of you, it is the beat of your heart is to be near to him. And yet the truth rings. Jesus is always most concerned. He is always challenging the heart of his disciples. And it shows up in lust, in greed, in anger. And we see in the Old Testament and the New Testament this idea that we get to guard our hearts because from our hearts flows all that we are, all of life. When we're parenting, sure, I know that like survival is probably your daily goal if your kids are young, or maybe if your kids are older. Like it's a pretty low bar. Like, what's the goal in parenting? It is to survive the day. But if we're able to breathe or have a moment to think, it is always to search, to listen, and to aim to shape the heart of our kids, because it is from their heart that everything that they do shows up. It's from the heart where words blossom. It's from the heart that all actions are birthed. And so you can have a child that obeys all the rules, and he's far from you, far from the Lord. You can have a child that's wayward, but his heart is captured, and it might not show up day to day, but there's something in there. And so we must challenge the heart always. And this isn't, to be clear, this is not just affirming like the Jesus knows my heart excuse for sin against God. That's not what I'm saying when I say obedience is a matter of the heart, or walking with Jesus is a matter of the heart. That's not what I'm saying. It means that we can try to do good, but if our hearts are far from God, eventually we will be exposed. Eventually we will show our cards, and we will reveal if we've been bluffing all along by all the things that we've worn, good deeds or generosity or whatever it is, or if our hand holds up when the going gets tough. We will reveal our true self. We will declare our allegiance of heart when things are difficult. And that usually happens when it matters most, and not when nothing is on the line, but when safety or security or life is in the balance, when spears are thrown, when kings or commanders make demands, when you have the opportunity to defend the innocent or condemn the innocent for your personal gain. In our journey through 1 Samuel, life has been in the balance seemingly on every page for quite a while. Lots of spears thrown, and the camera has been on Saul and David, and rightfully, as we're seeing God's kind of redemptive plan unfold through his kingdom, through his kings. But here we see some secondary and maybe even like some just some stand-in characters enter the scene, what we see is that our heart's deepest allegiance, it shows up when the going gets tough. And we're going to see that teased out, I hope, in this passage in kind of three pairs of heart motivation. And we get to see life and action that play out in the heart of our characters. And the thing that we're constantly looking at is not just what they're doing, but why are they doing it? It's not just what they're doing, but why are they doing it? And if we can look at them and we can ask the question, gosh, okay, we get to have a handle on what they're doing, whether it's good or bad, but why are they doing that? And if we can begin to evaluate and assess our own lives in the same way, it's not just what I'm doing, but why am I doing that? I think we can learn something about us, about the Lord, about our hearts from this passage. So the first thing is this: allegiance plays out through power and fear. And I want to read starting in verse 6. Saul heard that David and his men had been discovered. Saul's the king. David is the newly anointed king. God said he's going to be king, but no one quite knows that yet. David is Saul's son-in-law, and Saul has been trying to kill David for like 10 chapters. And David's like, dude, I got no beef. Legit, I don't. And so he's been running from him. That's kind of the setup. So Saul heard David and his men had been discovered. At the time, Saul was in Gibeah, sitting under the tamarisk tree at the high place. His spear was in hand, and his servants were standing around him. This is like classic ancient Near East literature. Like, he's in a grove under trees, which is really common. He's got a spear, which as you read chapter after chapter, they always describe the spear next to him, and it's viewed like a scepter of the king, except for this king is not ruling. He's throwing his spear at people, a little tip of the hat of what's inside of Saul. Saul said to his servants, listen, men of Benjamin, is Jesse's son going to give you all the fields and the vineyards? That's David. He just like can't make himself say his name. So he's just Jesse's son. It's like Jesse's girl, but Jesse's son. It's different. Do you think he'll make all of you commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds? That's why all of you have conspired against me. Nobody tells me when my son makes a covenant with Jesse's son. None of you cares about me or tells me that my son has stirred up my own servant to wait in ambush for me, as is the case today. That's not true. That is not true. Then Doeg, or Doug, right, the Edomite, who was in charge of Saul's servant, answered, I saw Jesse's son come to Ahimelech, son of Ahitub, at Nob. Ahimelech inquired of the Lord for him and gave him provisions. He also gave him the sword of Goliath, the Philistine. We'll stop there. That's actually what Pastor Scott preached on last week. And that's the chapter prior to this. The whole scene, Doeg was there, and he was like lurking in the shadows, and now he's like, he has something to say, right? And so this is what I want us to know. Power is not the enemy. This is a bit of a preface. Power is not the enemy. And in today's culture, if you have power, like, gosh, you're the enemy, right? That's the way that it works. That is a cheap lie to accuse anyone with power of being wicked. It's cheap. It's what happens through the power that we have that is either righteous or wicked. Any power that any of us have, and I would argue that every one of you have some power, some self-governance, some power, and certainly it's by degree, and some of you might lead hundreds or thousands of people, and some of you might lead yourself, but we have some power. Christians are empowered with all authority to make God's kingdom known. So we get to walk in power. Fear is something that we all must do. We all must fear. To fear the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. And so we start there. And what that means is we acknowledge his greatness. We acknowledge that he could snap his fingers and all would be gone. But because his power is not wicked, he hasn't done that. Because his power is good, we get to acknowledge that. And as we get to know him, the way that we fear him completely, it gives way to love when we know him rightly. There's a book by Chuck DeGroat, I believe is his name. It's called When Narcissism Comes to Church. And for some, it would be a tough read because there's just lots of tough stuff. But I just want to read some quotes. And again, we're thinking about Saul in the way that he is leading in this context. A few quotes. Narcissism in the church is often hidden behind a mask of spirituality. Narcissism thrives in systems where image is everything. A narcissistic leader often uses charisma to manipulate rather than to serve. Narcissism in the church silences dissent and elevates the leader to a near divine status. It's in some theological circles, you have like the man of God, and no one can come against the man of God. And it's horrendous. Healing from narcissistic abuse requires a community committed to truth and grace. Narcissistic leaders are often skilled at portraying themselves as victims when confronted. Again, think about what Saul is saying. Spiritual abuse occurs when leaders use their authority to control and manipulate. Narcissistic symptoms prioritize appearance over authenticity, outward rather than genuine. Narcissistic leaders often create environments of fear and dependency. I've never said the word narcissist so many times in my life. Probably not again. Narcissists demand loyalty while offering none in return. True Christian leadership is about vulnerability and servanthood, not power and control. See, I've struggled with Saul, and in my community group, we process, right? From the time that we got to know him till now, and it's been a bit of like like there's like something in there, and but here we finally see him squeezed, and like a sponge, it reveals what's inside of him. He's wrung out. His heart and his motives are plain to see. We are all revealed when the going gets tough. But Saul, he's no longer playing spiritual games. He's no longer trying to save face. He's no longer trying to lead God's people in God's ways for God's glory. He is just outright opposing God. And just whether you're there today or you find yourself there in the future, that is not a good place to be where we find Saul today. So we see the wicked kind of power and fear at work, and its motivator is pride. It's self-oriented. Saul powers up, but he's afraid of being abandoned for a better king. He looks super tough. Hey, spear in hand, blame game. He powers up. I'm the king, don't you know? But he's afraid of being abandoned for a better king. And he's already said, he knows that David is the rightful, that he's God's man, and that he is the better king. Look at motivations. Why is Saul doing what he's doing? Doeg, he speaks up. No, none of the servants in this room would actually go and engage when Saul invites them to, but because he's afraid of going unnoticed by the king with power. That's why Doeg would do anything that he does here. He's afraid of going on unnoticed, and he has some level of like intelligence, and he's like, wait, I could be in good graces with the king because of the information that I saw yesterday. Like, okay, none of these people are speaking up. I'm going to step into this, and King Saul, my Lord, I have some information that can help you get your guy. Speak up. See, paranoia is a byproduct of pride and fear. And we see it all over the pages with Saul. Paranoia is a byproduct of pride and fear. It plays out on these pages, and it plays out on Twitter. And it plays out in your own life. Whether you believe things that are true or whether you believe lies that you contrive in your own mind. Paranoia plays games. Paranoia calls allies villains. That's what's happening page after page. My enemy is out to get me. David is not your enemy. He is not out to get you, Saul. Paranoia is self-fulfilling fear. You are against me. No, 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 Saul, I'm not. You are against me. No, no, I'm not. You are against me. No, I'm not. But if you throw your spear at me one more time, bet I will be against you. It's self-fulfilling. And maybe you've seen people like that in your own life. Maybe you are people like that in your own life. And my prayer is that this would be, that the Spirit would bring sobriety to our heads and our hearts today. Doeg, he goes on to kill 85 priests. The entire town of priests. I think it would be the equivalent of like going to Southern Seminary and just slaying everyone. Future pastors that are being trained. That's what, it's a whole town being trained to be priests. And he does that when no one else would. Why would Doeg do that? We get to like, we don't know. There's no commentary on it. We just see what happens. It's because he wants a seat at the king's table no matter what this king's kingdom represents. And that's a problem. So the question is for us, how are power and fear at play in our own lives? How are pride-fueled power and fear at play in your world? Do you influence others for good and for the glory of King Jesus? Or do you demand your way? Look, and it doesn't have to be this big whatever. It's just in the subtlety even of your day. How does this play out? If you hold a position of power, what do your employees, what do your students, what do your athletes, what do your kids think matters most to you? Is it you? Is it how their performance reflects on you? Like, that is really easy. I mean, grocery, kids, stop. Like, your kid's acting like a whatever. But in the essence of, you're just thinking, stop making me look like a fool. Stop making me, and what I would say, this moment, gosh, it's not about you. You coach a team that's 0-13, and you have a conversation with the athletic director, like, maybe you're a bad coach. Like, okay, that's fine. But how does it show up when you show up on Monday at practice with the kids? Is it, you guys are making me look bad? Are you care for them, or do you care for you? Look, I've interacted with enough youth sports coaches to see that it takes a real man to scream at middle school kids until they fear you and they hate the sport that they once loved, because you never had power in your entire life, and when you got it, rather than building up for good, you scream at a broken relationship of your past, your parents, your boss, an abuser, and it takes the form of the 13-year-old kid in front of you. Why do we do what we do? Like, peel back layers. Reflect. This is a good thing. So it's definitely what we do in this life. Like, it can't just be a matter of like, ah, I didn't mean to or whatever. But what we do is a spotlight on why we do what we do. Jesse's son will never give you the fields and the vineyards. Jesse's son will never make you a commander. He will never give you the power that I offer. This is why you conspired against me. None of you care about me. That's literally what Saul says. None of you care about me. Or maybe they do care about you, Saul, but the care isn't in the form that you hoped for, or the care isn't in the form that feels good. It isn't an affirming care, but it's a revolting care, because they care for you in a way that shows what you need, not what you want. See, all that matters of the heart. Yet for now, oh, like, we can't just sit there. Like, that's pretty grim. Like, for now, we live in this world, and it's broken, and it's sin-stained, and we have choices to be this person or to reject the impulses of power motivated by fear, to work for this person or to confront, to live with this person, or to find another path to get along in this world. And so two questions we have to ask is this happening through me, and is this happening to me? And look, I don't have all the time in the world to process, right? If you're sitting there and you're saying, wait a minute, I'm suddenly being reminded of 1,000 conversations I've had over the last 20 years. People telling me that they're afraid to confront me, that they can't quite speak the truth to me because of the way. Is this happening through me? Look, this is going to be difficult. It is not going to be easy for you. And the first assessment question would be, am I always defensive when someone comes at me, or am I first reflective? Do I say, or do I just start building my defenses and like, I am a skilled attorney at defending myself? One famous pastor said of his church and the mission of his church, he said, there is a pile of dead bodies behind my church's bus, and by grace, it will be a mountain by the time we're done. Like, that shouldn't feel good. Like, the question you have to ask is the mission of your church the same mission of Jesus, who is the head of the church? Because, gosh, that doesn't sound like something Jesus would say. Is this happening through me? Is this you? And my gut is, you are in this room. By the numbers, you have to be. And secondly, you are just blind as could be to see it. Is this happening to me, right? If it's happening through you, you need cut down. If it's happening to you, you need built up, right? If I'm experiencing this, then what might it require of me? Well, there's a million things, and it depends on lots of scenarios or whatever. Maybe you have to engage. Maybe you have to endure, depending on the situation. Maybe you have to evacuate immediately, as it is an urgent situation. And so no matter where you find yourself, no matter how you answer either of those questions, there might be counseling required. Like, reach out to me, to someone. You can email men@myvillagechurch.com or women@myvillagechurch.com, and someone will follow up with you confidentially and allow you to process and find ways forward. There's certainly a requirement for accountability, right? Depending on where you find yourself in this, and repentance and reconciliation, but none of this is easy, right? Can we move on? Moving on. Allegiance plays out, secondly, through conviction and truth. So let's hop in verse 11. Then the king ordered the guards standing by him, "Turn and kill the priests of the Lord, because they sided with David, for they knew he was fleeing, but they didn't tell me. But the king's servants would not lift a hand to execute the priest of the Lord." So the king said to Doeg, he said, "Go and execute the priest." So Doeg went, and he went and executed the priest himself. On that day, he killed 85 men who wore linen ephods. There's a lot going on there. I want to read a quote by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He was a pastor, theologian, born in 1906. He died, he was 39. That's wild. And then I was saddened by that this morning, and I thought, gosh, what have I done with my life? That's what I thought. So I'll read this. I'll tell you a bit more about him in a minute. He was opposing the Nazi regime, right? He says, "You have only one master now. But with this yes to God belongs just as clear a no. Your yes to God requires your no to all injustice, to all evil, to all lies, to all oppression and violation of the weak and poor, to all ungodliness and to all mockery of what is holy. Your yes to God requires a no to everything that tries to interfere with your serving God alone, even if that is your job, your possessions, your home, or your honor in this world. Belief means decision." I hear that birds of a feather, they flock together. And conviction and truth, they are birds of a feather. And they are, as one historian says, they are like peas and carrots, right? Conviction and truth. If truth establishes your way, your convictions, your allegiance, they're unwavering. But if public appeal directs your steps, your thirst for power or your praise of mankind, then you are unstable. You are unpredictable even to yourself because you don't know what you would do to gain the praise of man. And conviction and even truth becomes a moving goalpost to accomplish your ends rather than something real, rather than something worthwhile, rather than something worth dying for. And look, if it's something worth dying for, then believe me, it is worth living for. And maybe that is the question that we get to ask, like, what would I be willing to die for? Because I think the reality is that many of us just float along. And you think of scenarios or you hear about it and you're like, oh, I would like to think, but what would you die for? Because if you can answer that, then you might figure out what you're actually living for. Why you wake up? What makes for good days or bad days? Imagine the pressure here. King confronts the priest. They can either cower or confront. They can either lie or speak truth. They can either defend the innocent or heap hatred upon the innocent to spare themselves. And the king demands to them, the king's servants that are around him, like they're really important characters in this chapter. They're standing around him, and he says to his servants, kill Ahimelech. Kill him. And they just, you know, don't make eye contact. And I think one of them grabs like a broom. He's just like I'm just, he was talking to you. He wasn't talking to me, you know, like, and they don't do it. The king with a spear. Kill this man. Kill this innocent man. Right? And the charge against Ahimelech is you helped David so that he might wait in ambush to kill me. But what was happening was David was fleeing. And he said, do you have some food, Ahimelech? Do you have some food or anything like that? And Ahimelech says, Saul, I've done this before. This is very common. He is your son-in-law after all. He is the commander of your troops. Why would I not serve him? And Saul's telling him, no, you're out to get me. And Ahimelech says, that is just not true. David's not out to get you. He's your best commander. He's like the best thing that you have going for you. Why are you trying to kill him? Please, don't bring harm to me or my family. Yet, truth and conviction, kill them. We will not. They are the undoeg in this chapter. The undoeg. We must understand, just as Bonhoeffer was a follower of Jesus opposing the Nazi party, his yes to Jesus required a no to everything that tries to interfere with his serving God alone. And his decision to say yes to Jesus and no to the Nazi regime led to his death by hanging. That's how Bonhoeffer died. Recant. I will not recant. I have one king. And he doesn't have a mustache. His name is Jesus. Ahimelech and Saul's servants doing the Lord's work, dealing with a power-hungry, narcissistic, spear-wielding king. His belief meant decision. His decision comes at a cost. The cost causes death, and not only his own, but an entire town of priests. And even in that, God was at work. Like, we don't have time, but in the second chapter of 1 Samuel, God, he prophesies and he promises that Eli's sons would die on the same day. And then he promises that the household would be cut off, that the household of priests, the lineage of priests would be cut off. And he says that the household would be grieved and saddened by a violent death as they are cut off from the line of priests. This sounds kind of like that's happened. 85 priests dead at the sword of Doeg. So even in judgment, it is pride and fear that find their end because of conviction in truth. It is God's character revealed in his determination to be truth, to establish truth, to compel truth, to build a way in a people that's built upon him, not merely as an example, but as the one who transforms our heart's compass so that we might be truth people. Look, it's fall. Get over it. Summer's over. Okay? And that means for me that as I go into like fall, into winter, there are certain movies that I watch, and one of those is the Pirates of the Caribbean. And we'll talk about it every winter until the day that I die, all right? It's not the greatest movies ever, but Jack Sparrow, you can't say the word compass without talking about this. Jack Sparrow, he has a compass, and it doesn't point north, and so everyone assumes it's broken. But what does it point to? It points to what he loves the most, right? And so, in one sense, it shows him where to find what he values most. But on the other hand, it's like a thermometer that tells him what he loves most, right? And what, when we trust God by faith through grace in Jesus, the Spirit seals us for the day of redemption. And what that means is he reestablishes our heart's compass to point to his glory always. Now, you can reject that. You can walk away from that. But he gives us new hearts so that we might be able to assess what it is that we're living for most, what it is that we build our convictions upon, this book and the new heart that we're given. That means that we, by faith, we are anchored to the unwavering way, truth, and life. And not only are we anchored, but we are transformed to be people of conviction and truth. And that shows up in how we defend and how we own and how we vote and who we marry or who we don't marry and where we work and how we lead and how we serve and in all of our relationships and where our money goes and where our time goes, what stirs the affections of our heart, what gives us life, how we pray, what and how we live, and what and how we love. Not because we have to, but because we can't not so that God will love us, but because he already does in Jesus. That's the heart of all the gospel stuff that we talk about. He loves you in spite of you. Receive that or reject that. Receive that unto life, reject that, and find death. Or as one regional manager of a paper company was asked, they asked him, would you rather be feared or loved? And he said, easy, both. I want people to be afraid of how much they love me. And then he goes on, he says, I think I proved that in the dojo today, right? To be clear, this doesn't mean that we become jerks. Like, we start talking about conviction and truth, and then we just shed every other command. We just shed every other motive. It's like conviction and yes. And so, like, you hear me talk, and you're like, okay, let's go. And you're, like, putting on the, you know, all the battle. And, like, we're in a battle, so that's good. But then, like, then we forget about the character and the way and the nature of how these things play out. It does not mean that we just become jerks. It's not a, well, you know, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm just being honest. Like, what do you want me to do? That's not what it is. We get to not protect the world from truth, not protect our neighbors from truth, but to build up in the way of truth. That means we get to listen and engage in love and care and speak truth in a world of lies. But don't mishear truth as jerk. And do not mishear love as lie, right? Because of sin, our default heart condition is set to self. It is set to Saul, right? Saul. That's how we begin. We're born into Adam, and we're born into Saul and into Doeg. I will be king, or I will use the king's power to serve my own ends. But our one true better King, Jesus, who rules and reigns and who will return, he takes our hearts of stone and he gives us hearts of flesh to beat, blood transformed by the blood that he shed to transform us from passive and fearful, from power hungry and prideful, to people who hold truth as our compass and who live out truth-formed conviction even when it costs us. So what that means is that we get to be people who are consistent in our belief, in our word, and in our deed. And all that, it builds a culture of humility. And if a narcissist is self-aware, absorbed and preoccupied with self. Humility has a modest view of one's importance. Like, we know where we fit, right? Which takes us to the third thing. Allegiance plays out through humility and safety. I'll read the last three verses. However, one of the sons of Ahimelech, son of Ahitub, escaped. So one of the priests escaped the massacre. His name was Abiathar, and he fled to David. Abiathar told David that Saul had killed the priest of the Lord. Then David said to him, "I knew that Doeg the Edomite was there that day, and that he was sure to report to Saul." He's like, gosh, when all that stuff went down, I remember seeing Doeg there. Listen to what he says. "I myself am responsible for the lives of everyone in your father's family." That's quite a different response. "Stay with me. Do not be afraid, for the one who wants to take my life wants to take your life. You will be safe with me." David, I myself am responsible. Is he responsible? Well, not directly, and maybe you could say, well, if he knew, like, whatever. But he takes it on. Yet even with his name and his future and his kingship campaign on the line, he takes ownership, and he acts like a leader. And his aim is to rescue if he can. And there's just something about this that is refreshing, and it just feels impossible in today's political campaigning. Yeah, that's on me. Can you imagine? Like one of our politicians being like, yeah, I messed up. Those lives, yeah, I did that. Wasn't what I intended, but can you imagine that? Can you imagine that state of the union? Imagine if our leaders, they came together and acknowledged the strength of the others. Imagine if they owned bad decisions, took responsibility for their error, they were established enough in truth and their conviction for the kingdom, not their own image or their own slice of the kingdom, that they could own their part. Then maybe we could begin building a kingdom of truth and love and responsibility and accountability and humility. Look, I don't care what side you're on. Like, we, surely, we can agree on that. Look, and this is not a call simply to be nice, right? Or to just own everything and to be a doormat and to always fall on your own sword. It's not that at all. But it is a call to be strong enough to confess weakness, to be free enough to be honest about yourself and others, to be formed by God's transforming love and grace. Enough to live a life of transforming love and grace, so much that we would stand with our King, even at great cost. And to be clear, standing with King Jesus, it may not necessarily be hinged to what you think that it is. What we don't get to do is we don't get to put a flag in Jesus' hand that he is not himself waving. We don't get to connect him to our side projects. The reality is I'm saying these things and people on both sides of any issue would be like, yes and amen. We don't get to hijack the kingdom of God for our person, party, for our truth, for our version of love, for our idea of freedom, for our self-autonomy. We don't get to do that. King Jesus is not to be used to endorse your movement beyond repent and believe. So we must get behind the movement that prioritizes yes to him, and with that comes a decisive no to movement against him, movement against his way, movement against his truth, movement against his love, movement against his life. That's what all this means. We can't sort of do any of this Jesus is the humble rescuer. He is our place of safety. David takes responsibility for his own miss that led to the death of God's priest, but there is a better king, priest, servant who took responsibility not for his own sin, for his own miss, but for the sin of all of his people, for all who would turn to him and call upon his name. And he laid down his own life, being God, not considering equality a thing to be grasped, but he humbled himself to death, even death on a cross, so that we might be welcomed and brought into the safety of his arms as citizens of his humble, powerful kingdom. So just real quickly, why don't we walk in humility? One, we have something to prove. Just think about it. Like every single day, like right now, I am tempted. Look, right in this very moment, I am tempted to try to prove something. You know that? I have conversations all week long, and some of them are affirming, and some of them are not so affirming. So I'm just like you, 1,000 voices in my head saying, I have to lead like this. I have to look, preaching must look, 1,000 voices. If I have something to prove, then I'm going to pull back punches. Right? How does that show up in your life? The reality is the most beautiful thing about being in the kingdom of God by trusting Christ alone and nothing that you can contribute with your own hands, the most beautiful thing is you no longer have anything to prove. Deep sighs every day of your life. I don't have anything to prove. Nothing to prove. I don't have to. I get to do the work of the kingdom. I get to do the work of my hands. I get to be a good whatever it is. Neighbor, dad, coach, boss, employee, whatever it is. The second thing, why don't we walk in humility? We're afraid our confession of weakness will be ammunition against us. You know what? It will be. So then we go back to point number one. It's really hard to confess things about ourselves that we know. Like, can you imagine if Saul and David then had a political campaign? And Saul says himself, he's the one responsible for the 85 priests that died. Look, cue the clip. And David said, I did this, right? It's over. He can't get elected. But guess what? We don't live for this world. We live for the kingdom beyond this one. Let's go on. The third one is this. We don't believe that Jesus is the king of all kings and king of our own heart. That's why I don't walk in humility. Because if I believe that, then I would get to build my life around the way and the truth and the life. That's Jesus. When I live in a way that doesn't put that on display, I'm not believing that Jesus is king of all kings. I think there are better kings, other kings. And I don't believe that he's king of my own heart. Our heart's deepest allegiance shows up when the going gets tough. And if our heart's deepest allegiance is to King Jesus, then together we put on the kingdom of God. There's this place, it's called Key West Bistro. And you can imagine what that would look like. Bright colors and pictures of the ocean and video, you know, TVs with ocean scenes. It's quite a vibe. Kind employees, Cuban coffee, because Key West is just like basically Cuban. It's just all the way down there, right? Some type of, I talked to the guy, I don't know, gelato or something that's like only made in Key West, right? The only thing was I went into this place in Minneapolis, Minnesota. True story. And it was just like, what just happened? And I was with a couple friends, and so we're talking to him, what we find out is this dude loves Key West, right? And so he's an outpost for the culture of Key West. He's bringing the Key West culture to Minneapolis, and it showed up in his passion for this place, and he's sharing stuff that, like, just, okay, like, type of coffee and all this stuff, and it looked and it smelled and it tasted and it felt like Key West, but it wasn't. He put the kingdom of Key West on display, and we get to make the kingdom of God visible. And look, guys, we don't live in Key West. Even when everything is on the line, we get to put the kingdom of God on display. And we can only do that when Jesus is actually king of our lives and he actually shapes and forms and transforms and conforms and changes every part of how we live and how we work and how we play and how we think and how we engage. Following Jesus is a matter of the heart. As sinners in need of rescue from sin and hell and the grave, our only response is to repent and to believe, to turn from and to trust Jesus above everything else. My question is, would you do that today? Right? The band can come on up. We get to respond through all of this stuff, and you can sit right where you are and you can pray. God is, he wants to hear from you. Right? You are not too far gone. He wants to hear from you. You can sit right where you are. You can stand up and pray. You can pray at that prayer bench. You can pray with someone over there. They would love to pray with you. If you're in Christ, you can respond by remembering and declaring the truth of the gospel, that he lived perfectly, that he died with sin on him, not his own, but our own. And that it was by his broken body and his blood that was spilled that we get to declare the present and future kingdom that he invites us into. And so we do that by taking the bread and the cup to remember his body broken, his blood spilled. Right? Would you pray with me? God, thanks for your goodness and your grace. Thanks for your word, that it transforms us by your Spirit. Would you shine bright light in all the dark places? Would you let it not condemn us? But would you let it boldly invite us into new life, whatever that looks like today, a next step with you? Would you let it begin with humble repentance and honest confession to you by your grace in Jesus' name? Amen.